Editorial Conference. This is a panel conference in World Hindu Congress 2018, Chicago. This is one of the seven conferences, as you know, and we have seven sessions between today and tomorrow. I'm here as one of the coordinators. My fellow coordinator is Vikas Deshpande. Vikas, can you please stand up wherever you are? There. Hard work over the past few months putting together these sessions and a galaxy of speakers. The first session speakers are right here in front of you. This is the session on news media and the Hindu point of view there. This session is going to be chaired by R. Jagannathan, an eminent editor of an eminent weekly Swarajya. These days, these frequencies are irrelevant because Swarajya gets updated online by the minute. That is one of the issues we are going to talk about, how media, thanks to technology, is changing and media consumption is changing and is impacting the content generation as well. He's going to chair this session, and the speakers in this session are from my extreme right, Prafulla, pun not intended. He edits Organiser, a weekly based in Delhi. To his left is Hitesh, Shankar. He edits another weekly called Panchjanya, comes out from Delhi in Hindi. I have already introduced R. Jagannathan to you. And we have Mr. Shri Iyer. This eminent panel is going to discuss. Francois Gautier is on his way, he is expected. He's another very eminent Western journalist who's today based in India, in Aurobindo, Pondicherry. And he backs for India, he backs for Hindu causes like I haven't seen any other Western journalist do in the recent years. He's also championed the cause of Kashmiri Hindus and the destruction of their heritage and temples, single-handedly moved around with an exhibition across the country. Man of His Eminence, part of this panel, is a great fortune. So this high-bar panel is going to discuss how Hindu point of view today is missing from news, and if at all it is trying to muzzle its way in, what kind of challenges it faces, what kind of distortions, what kind of attacks we experience on the way. I'll take this opportunity to also give you a very brief overview of the media conference itself. We have specific sessions focusing on other aspects as well, such as the entertainment media, which again, besides the news media, has huge impact on how we perceive our world and what kind of images and values we derive. Entertainment media panel will have the eminence of Vivek Agnihotri, a noted filmmaker who is amongst us, and several other movies. We'll talk about social media, which is now challenging the mainstream media very effectively, in fact dictating the agenda to it. And people on Twitter, on Facebook, and several other social media platforms are literally pushing, reprioritizing, and challenging established norms of presenting news. We'll have a session on technology, how media consumption itself is changing, even as we don't realize how our own media consumption habits are changing and how we as a society must prepare for future in order to use this opportunity more effectively. We'll have a session on the commerce of media, because economics is what determines the success or failure of these initiatives. and how that is going to change in view of changing technology, changing consumption of media, and new ways of consuming media emerging. We'll also have an open session where some of the issues thrown up across these sessions will be discussed, and session chairs will be here to answer the questions that you may have had, though there will be interaction opportunity at the end of each session itself. But open session is a session devoted to delegates who participated in the media conference over the next 2 days. So we start with the session on news media and the Hindu agenda. Okay, so before we start, there's a curtain raiser of sorts. Shri Anupam Kher, who was going to be part of this conference, had to rush for his other preoccupations. There's a Toronto Film Festival going, he has a movie. But he sent a message, we are grateful for that, and let's see that message, and then we'll kick off this conference. Over to Anupam Kher. People waiting outside, if they can find seats here. I'm afraid there are very few left.
We are going to open the party.
Okay. Volunteers, kindly help those who are left without seats, or we can create some space by removing the barge.
We are going to remove this partition so that it brightens up within a second.
Grateful. Can we have the lights dimmed, please? Can the people in that corner see the screen?
Yes.
Okay.
Thank you.
I think we are having some technical difficulties. We'll play this video a little later. Let's get on with the session and I hand it over to you, Mr. Jagannathan.
Hello friends, I'm very happy to be here with all of you. I hope we have a...
Keep it close. Keep the mic close.
Hello. Thank you. I hope you have a very pleasant and an interesting afternoon where there's a lot of power, where there's a lot of tension, because I think the world outside is full of it, and I think it's ideal that in a media conference you have that kind of tension, because media is at the thick of it all, it's the center of it all. Okay, so the plan for the discussion right now will go something like this. I'll do an initial sum up of what I think is happening in the media so far. And what are the challenges ahead? It will be in a small PowerPoint where you can read the stuff, but I won't necessarily dwell on every single point. So I'll quickly go through it in 3 or 4 minutes. After that, each one of the panelists will talk for about 3 to 5 minutes. Some of them might do it with the PowerPoint, some might just speak. Okay, so that we need to think. After that, then we'll have a discussion among the panelists And after that, in the last segment, which is about 15-20 minutes, we can ask for questions from the audience. But in case you want to ask a question in the middle while there is a discussion, please raise your hand and if we'll try and bring you in at the appropriate time to ask the question so that the thing. But as far as possible, we'll keep it to the end so that the conversation is not interrupted. Okay? Yeah. Yes, I think when you come to that, I'll give all the hygiene points. Okay. So, thank you. So, can you put the PowerPoint, please? Okay. Okay. So we'll start the process. Let me do one thing. We'll start with the scene as it exists now. We know what happened in the last 5 years. I think suddenly you've seen a profusion of new voices, distinct voices coming through the social media. Voices have been democratized. Earlier it was only a top-down dialogue where you had media, you had a media interview, and you were an audience who were being broadcast to. Now the communication is top to down, down to the thing, and sideways. So it's actually the arrival of social and digital media has democratized communication in this country. Of course, some people don't like it, so which is why everybody is running around saying, oh, there is fake news, and things like that. When they have not bothered all these years about fake narratives. Problem is not about somebody using a morph photo or something like that, which can quickly be detected by technology and other things. The problem is, in journalism we tell stories, and when you tell the wrong story, that's actually worse than if you just use the morph picture. Though of course that has its own dangers. So we look at fake news in its own way. So I'll start the process by this thing, giving you a summary of that. Please move to the next slide. Yeah, so this is what has happened in the last 5 years, starting with 2012, right up to now. We have seen an increased amount of voices giving the other narrative slowly coming up. We have seen the mainstream media being challenged. Earlier we used to have only one establishment, that is the government. Now the mainstream media, which is being displaced by this, has become another. Yeah. Okay. So you see that what's happening there. Basically, increasingly people have realized that their what they write, what they do is going to be questioned, and so they are organizing themselves for a big fight. You can see a lot of fight back is happening. You have seen a lot of funding coming in from all kinds of mainstream sources to people who will keep the original narrative of the previous regime alive. You've seen in places like the Scroll and Wire and so many other things like that. So we have to be prepared for a long, hard fight, and that's where I think we are going. Next slide. In all this, the mainstream media, that is both TV and print in a big way, is also getting into digital spaces because they know that the real voices are there. And the access to digital media on a handheld is now much, much wider than in just print or TV. Very few people watch print and TV anymore. I mean, most of it is happening, consumed on the mobile. So the challenge is coming, and everybody is actually investing in a big way in this kind of thing. This is the emerging scenario. However, there is a huge problem developing there. I mean, the legacy publishers are trying to see how to get into it. But the thing is, their revenues are plateauing. So actually, mainstream media is in deep trouble. It's actually many parts of it, not all of it. Many parts of it is actually, if you see the TV debates that are going on, they all have single formats where five guys shout at each other and go away. That's the cheapest form of news you can ever get. Because you don't need to do anything, you don't need to do a story, you don't need to meet anybody, you just call five guys, bash their heads together and send them home. That's what you get as news these days. And that's a dying format, and the media is killing itself in trying to do that kind of journalism. And increasingly you're going to find that they will ultimately migrate to the digital space, because that's the only place where your costs and your output will start matching somewhere. But they have huge establishments, they have to worry about it. So if you go to the next thing. if you talk about what's been seen in the last 3 years, I think in the first 2 years of the new government, we did not see so much polarization. But from 2015 and 2016 onwards, there has been a huge polarization, largely because I think the old establishment, media establishment, has been shunted aside and not been given much importance by the new government. And also the new voices in digital and social have actually started challenging their narratives. So what's really happening is, the stranglehold of the mainstream has actually been broken, but there is a huge challenge in the dharmic media because there are not too many of them, and they are also, we have a double problem. One, on the one hand, media, all media is supposed to keep government honest, but we have to keep two guys honest, two types of establishment. You've got an establishment that is the government, and you, which may be theoretically somebody you may want to work with, but you also have a media establishment. That the Lutyens media, which is actually also needs to be fought. So they're fighting on two fronts. So that's what is happening. So you've got to see which one you have to prioritize. So if you want a balanced dialogue, you need to have several other narratives. Okay. So please go forward. Next one. What we are now seeing is a huge infusion of fake narratives going all over the place. The reason is, as news people, we are supposed to tell stories, and the problem with media is that you can spin any story out of any kind of fact. What is a fact? Yes, we know that stones were thrown at a church, we know that some things happened, but you can make two kinds of narratives out of it. One is to build, saying that, oh, churches are under attack, which is one way of telling the story. The other is to say, look, there are also 260 temples that were attacked at the same time. In that narrative. So if you see the perspective, you will find that these are random events being spun into a story. So we are not just having fake news, we are having fake narratives being built up. And you can see that in all of these kinds. Go to the next slide, please. Okay, now you have, these are the kinds of headlines and fake narratives you are getting now. They are not untruths, but they are a partial rendering of the truth, which actually leads you in a direction which may not be right. Okay, you say, somebody being lynched, but you saw that people are being lynched for stealing goats, people are being lynched for being stealing, right, and you saw that people are being lynched for child lifting. We have seen all kinds of things. So what's really happening is, there is actually a basic failure of law and order in all states in this country. That is the main narrative, and the other things actually are being strung together into a narrative that is not related to what is happening in the larger state. If you actually see, this one part of lynching is only a partial truth. So partial truths are what are gaining prominence, and they need to be... Then you've got simple economic narratives. Okay, UPA grew at a faster rate than NDA, but what underlies that growth? Any government can get very high growth by just blowing up money. But when you act responsibly and bring this thing, then you will have slower growth for a while and before growth revives. But that narrative can't be told because it's difficult to explain to people. So the narrative that the UPA did very well stays. So many of these things we need to challenge, basically. So if you see the alternate, just go to the next slide. There are explanations that are quite different from the mainstream narrative, the way it's being strung. Go to the next one. So what we are really doing, and we need to understand the structure of how false narratives get played out, and as journalists we need to understand how we can spot them and try and correct them. I mean, if you see in all Western media, there is no talk about detecting fake news, but there is no attempt to detect fake narratives. That is really the challenge for Indian media, Hindu media, whatever you want to call it. You have to find the truth that is more than just a bunch of facts that lead in the wrong direction. You know, or facts, I mean, it's like the blind man and the elephant. You got hold of one side of it and you think that's the truth. It's not. I mean, this is where I think the real challenge is. Now, you can see what the techniques used to get the false narratives. You know? First of all, you have mainstream narrative will suggest the false things and then expect you to take a plan. This is what happened in Ayodhya, where suddenly, even this is there in the court document, where the left historians happily said that there was a Buddhist temple under the Babri Masjid and said it had nothing to do with it. Huh? Then you actually found that they said it without, they just concocted it. You know, so first suggest false things, that's how it works. That's how false, if you are the first with the false narrative, it tends to grow very fast. And that's basically what's happened. Second thing they use is use numbers without context. What happens, we have all heard the story about farmer suicides, right? And we say, if you actually keep counting them from 1947, you can say, oh, several lakh farmers have committed suicide. But if you actually look at it, what's the size of the farming population? It's about half the country. What is the percentage of suicides among farmers? 14%. Which means their suicide rate is far lower than that of any other group of identifiable individuals. Not that any suicide is a tragedy, but the truth is that farmer suicides do not exceed, they are far below the national average in terms of any particular group. So we are getting a false narrative that, oh, suddenly it's gone up. But it's not gone up. So you can use the numbers in a different way. Which is not to say that farmers are not facing poverty and all that. That's a separate story. But you can't fix it like that. I don't think they're the ones who are trying to give up their life because their life is difficult. In fact, it's the richer people who are actually giving up their lives more for other reasons. So the story of the suicide is a little more complicated than farmers leading the suicide. And this statistics is, by the way, not mine. This is done by some of the lefties. These are their own numbers. The P. Sainath and others. This is the result of their study. And they don't want to quote this. They just want to quote the total number. 2 lakh suicide between 1991 and 2000, whatever it is. But 2 lakhs in a country of 1.3 billion people is a very minuscule number compared to what you're talking about. Right? So numbers are something in other way, false narratives are something. Okay. So I'll go through that quickly. So what are we getting at? Yes, please go ahead. This next one. Yeah. Basically, I think narratives have got polarized. And there is a need for building a strong counter-narrative that is which is necessary in order to arrive at higher truths. We are at lower levels of truths where some facts are strung together into a narrative which are false, and because the ecosystem exists to escalate it. Because any false narrative in English media will suddenly get into the New York Times the next day. I mean, you know what the power of that media. And that's where I think you need to be careful, and you need to make sure that your side of the voice gets a little louder and a little wider. So we need to look at the whole structure of the media and that. Social media is important, but I think more than social media, I think we need to be outside the social media, also in the regular kind of this. Now, the next slide. So what we are trying to say is that I think if you want to control the narrative in future, you need to go into the regional media. I think the English media's best days are over. I think it's the regional media where you need to go. And in all senses, circulation rates are growing at twice as much as English media. Revenues are growing at twice the rate of the English media. So we are talking about the future is really in regional media, which my colleague will further dilate on. So I think that's where we need to have the numbers. I mean, some of these tables will show you where the numbers are. So, and they will actually, just go to the second last slide. So the key point is, I think Hindu media needs to dominate digital media, and for that we need large investments. They're not actually very large, and I'll give you an estimate of what I think it costs to produce a decent media in any particular language. We have 10 or 15 major languages, and we need to dominate those things. Costs are not very high. I think I'll come into those details a little later in the discussion. So meanwhile, I'll hand over the mic to colleague, we'll talk about the regional media and its importance there.
Thank you. You touched upon points, but I would like to elaborate further. While discussing news media in Hindu perspective, especially regionalism and readership concern, we must not forget that in Bharat, a lot of our great people, as high as Adi Shankaracharya to Swami Vivekananda to APJ Abdul Kalam, they are not from Hindi speaking area. So regionalism, even in media, it is not an issue for as it is not being used as fault line of Hindu society. It is a fact that regionalism is one of the favorite topics for breaking India brigade. We must not forget. It is also true that this breaking India brigade is still quite powerful in our newsrooms, sitting firmly in mainstream news media, I think. And further, I would like to add, pseudo-operational frame of regionalism is actually a framework to pit and put Hindu and Hindi versus other Indian or regional languages and identities also, to keep nation divided. So the narrative of regionalism is basically not only a phony, but it is also meant to keep India weak and divided. It was meant to keep a check on nationalistic feeling. But interestingly, due to increased literacy rate, enhanced purchasing power and IT for all, the mainstream is not in the position to claim itself mainstream anymore, I think. Presently in India, the rise of nationalistic feeling goes across the language, which is quite visible. You can notice on web portals or regional edition, it is quite visible. I am waiting for my slides. Yes. It is a fact, when you see kind of saturation in West for newspaper consumption, it is totally different story in India. Newspaper are still growing. And out of 110 news readers, 70 millions were from rural areas and urban share remained at 40 million. Print media is estimated to grow at an overall... Overall CAGR of approximately 70% until 2020, with vernacular growing at the percentage of 8 to 9%. Second slide. Along with news media, TV is quite strong. Even today, TV media marching strong. Last 15 years witnessed impressive growth in numbers of news channels, and totally it is around 182 channels we have. You can read it out. Time is running, so you can put the next slide, please. Online is a game changer. Very recent example I would like to present. I just make a Facebook live of Mohanji's speech. Can you imagine how many readers I can get? At the time when in India it is 10 o'clock around, the reach was like 40,000 plus. And speech was in English, and my platform was Hindi, and people are responding even at that time. It shows that where we have audiences in English media, they don't have, they are lacking their readership, their audience, they are lacking. Digital media grew 29.4% in advertising and 50% in subscription during 2017. Subscription, which was just 3.3% of total digital revenue in 2016, is expected to grow to 9% by 2020. Next slide, please. Vernacular language is way ahead of English. As I told you, the Indian consumer today spends about 50 to 60% of the average time on Hindi videos, followed closely by 35 to 43% on regional content video, with only 5 to 7% on English. Please note where English stands. As per KPMG India and Google report, Indian language internet users are expected to grow at a CAGR of 18% versus English user at a CAGR of 3%. Next slide, please. English versus regional. In 1990, India had 209 English dailies. Two decades later, the number had increased nearly sevenfold to 1,406. In 2020, Bennett Coleman, the publisher of the TOI, Times of India, the world's largest English daily, started a Bengali newspaper and poured fresh resources into the older Hindi and Marathi papers. It is the story of most popular English daily. The new middle class is increasingly found in the smaller towns and prefers to read in its own regional language rather than English. Meanwhile, major media houses have discovered that English readership is declining or stagnant, and the advertising rates in English papers cannot be pushed much higher. Next slide. Challenges of vernacular media. They have readers, but they have challenges too. Vernacular media lacks of infrastructure, and it has to work against all odds. The scope of revenue is also not at par with their English counterparts. Concentrating on the metros and big cities, the employees are poorly paid, and most of the staff are not even on regular basis. It is the inside story. Next slide, please. Strengths versus weaknesses. Strength and weaknesses are two words of entirely different meaning, characterizing two extremes. One denoting a system of fortifying, resisting any invasion, while the other one denotes vulnerability against such intrusions. In fact, both are the sides of same coin. A vast territory is one strength, it is weakness at the same time, since one need to protect the much territory to that no enemy is able to invade it. Next slide, please. English media comes with its own biases, and it is quite visible in India. English media usually paints a crime story as a story against a caste or community or minority. Sometimes they create fake stories too, and it refrained from highlighting the caste of region if aggressor is from other segment. Such news presentation mislead the reader and guide them to make wrong opinion. Next slide. Actually, in all this exercise, they are playing with fire. Finding marketability around the fault line of the society can participate into dangerous result, affecting the basic social fabric. Mainstream media has greater responsibility on its shoulders, but it has failed on many fronts. It is the vernacular media which has taken the charge. Next up. Hindu perspective of news. Hindu, or you can call it nationalist perspective, Hindutva is not at all biased on exclusion, rather inclusion is the guiding factor of all its principles. Each religion is regarded with same degree of respect. It has not only treat of human equal, but promote protection to its natural environment as well. It not only treat all human equal, And lastly, if there would be any Hindu perspective of the news, it would only do good to the society and the nation, as the essence of Hindutva lies in inclusion. I would like to add one more point. Whenever there is a situation when you have to expose the anti-national design, like there is Maoist activity or leftist activity, or church-related news, or Islamist extremism, like in Bengal, all you always found that vernacular media play differently and put different kind of perspective rather than English media and so-called mainstream media. It is the story. Thank you.
Give you a very general perspective on the state of the media and the trend towards regional. Now we'll get into something that's what's happening in various parts of it. I'll talk to Shri, who will launch PGurus as a specific media vehicle. Shri, why did you do it, and what do you think you're doing in terms of trying to change the narrative?
Hello, my name is Shri Iyer. I'm the editor of PGurus.com. By show of hands, how many of you read PGurus articles? That's impressive. Thank you so much. Please put the word out there. I got into journalism quite by an accident. I am your typical Silicon Valley guy. I've done a several bunch of startups, some well, some not so well. But that is the thing. The ride is more fun than the result. When I was looking at how events were folding or unfolding before the 2014 elections. And what sparked me was the fact that Modi was being prevented from going to Patna to address meetings. He said, well, you know, everybody should be given a chance to air their side of the view. You may agree with them, but you may not agree with them. So that was the first spark. And then after that, by around 2015, I said, you know, I think I know the technology part of it, but I also have another talent that I'm not using, and that was, I was born in Chennai, I grew up in Hyderabad, I went to a school that was run by Agarwals, my neighborhood was predominantly Kannada, so I kind of knew 6 or 7 languages. Because I was young, I would lap up all these things, I could read, write many of these things. I said, I'm not really making use of this talent of mine. And every time I would land in India, the poor taxi driver who would take me from the airport to the city had a really hard time, because I would impose on him that regional language, that he had no choice, because he was going to get money only if you drop me at my destination. But I would just plunge in and I'd start talking with him. But the thing that I liked was, many people appreciated the fact that somebody who's come from US is making an attempt to speak to them in the language, in their language, and that was really appreciated. And that kept me, you know, going, and I keep doing this thing. Back to PGurus. Now, what happened in 2015 was, I was thinking, you know, now that there's a new regime change, that the stock markets are going to start picking up, and let me start seeing if I can do some trading. And I would try to trade sitting in the US into Indian stock. Then I saw one day, I lost an unimaginable amount of money. I haven't even told my wife how much I've lost. But today the cat's out of the bag. So I said, there's something really wrong with the system. There's something called as a stop loss. I don't know how many of you trade stock. That stop loss is basically going to limit how much of money you're going to lose. That day, the stop loss went out of the window. It went way below, and there was nothing to stop it. And at the end of the day, you have to settle your accounts. So this spurred me, and I said, there is something wrong here. I need to really get to the bottom of it. And I'm still getting to the bottom of it. So those of you who read PGurus, you'll see me emphasizing on two things, even though I like to do four, but two things is what I emphasize on. Corruption in financial areas, and the other one is Hindutva. Personally, I consider myself as a Sanatani, follower of Sanatana Dharma, rather than a Hindu. Because to me, the word Hindu is foreign. It was something that was invented by the British to say those who are not this, 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 and this. But I like to think of myself as Sanatani. And if you look at India's history, you know, this dharma, Sanatana, by the way, means eternal, eternal dharma, which has been around for 7,000 years or more. We don't even know how far back it goes. It has existed from Iraq all the way up to Java, Indonesia, and even in Japan. And I have traveled extensively in many of these countries, and I've seen this Sanatana dharma come up in bits and pieces. For instance, in Taipei, I was searching for a vegetarian restaurant, and it's very difficult to find a vegetarian restaurant, and I don't really know the language. So somebody told me, you know, ask for a Buddhist restaurant, because if you go to a Buddhist restaurant, everything they serve there is vegetarian. And this first time I struggled. Next time what I did was, I found one Buddhist restaurant I liked, and I found a hotel close to that. That way I could go there anytime I want. I solved my most important problem of the day, which was to eat. The interesting thing about Buddhist restaurants is, you pay for your food by the weight. And it's usually, you know, a priest, and you know, we will talk a few things. I mean, he will try to talk to me in Sanskrit, and I was, you know, broken. You know how I am, you know, I'm always unleashing my knowledge of the thing. But it was always a pleasurable experience. I saw the same thing when I was in Japan, when I was in South Korea. I haven't been to Java. But I can see that there is an influence of this Sanatana Dharma everywhere. Even back home in the Silicon Valley, my hairdresser is from Vietnam. And one day I was a little early and I saw him do puja. He had a Buddha out, he had two agarbattis, he had a banana, and he did camphor. And he did the same thing that you would do in a Hindu puja. Then when he opened the shop, I said, "Hey Tony, I thought you were a Catholic." And he said, no, Sri, that was only because, you know, Catholic schools give scholarships to my kids, see. So, but at heart, he's still Sanatani. You see, so I think, even though we are seeing all these battles in India, you know, of conversion and whatever, the basic instinct inside is still one of a Sanatani. Do you pause to ask somebody who's hurt on the street and bleeding, if what his religion is before you take him to the hospital? No, the instinct kicks in. You just want to take him and go. So, back to PGurus. PGurus was one of the first websites to start highlighting some of the asymmetric coverage that has been happening in MSM. And I'm greatly indebted to social media for making PGurus what it is today. However, I'm also noticing now that social media is making digital slaves of all of us. So I would urge all of us to think about this. We get up in the morning, we have our favorite social media tool, either it's Facebook or Twitter, or some of us do WhatsApp is actually more than that. So you have this, I mean, we are completely slave to that. First thing we do, take it up, we see what is there, and we are members of 20 groups, 10 we chose, the other 10 others chose for us, and we are too nice to tell them, no, I really don't want to be. I mean, even when you get off something, somebody calls you back and says, no, I want you to be. Long story short, we have to be, you know, making sure that we don't get enslaved by anything. And I noticed that Facebook especially is creating this echo chamber where if you have an extremist point of view, all those people who are adhering to the same view start seeing this. So even if yours is a very wrong opinion, you start feeling that, oh, so many people have read this, that means I should be right. And I think this balancing has to be done. I don't know when Facebook is going to change its algorithms, but to me, I would like to leave with a message that I think all of us should take that it is a matter of sarva dharma samabhava. I used to read Taittiriya Upanishad when I was a kid, and the one line that has stayed with me all through my life, satyam vada dharmam chara, speak the truth, walk the path of dharma. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Francois. Two things. One is, there has been a lot of new voices in social and digital media. But overall, before you make a general point, will you focus on whether you think we are winning the war or losing it?
My name is Francois Gautier. I'm a French journalist and writer. I have the privilege to live in your country, India. Most of you live, are Indians who live abroad. I'm a Frenchman who lives in India. And I'm very privileged. It's been a great privilege to live in your country. I'm a defender of the Hindus. You know, there are very, very few journalists, Western journalists, who defend Hindus. And I'm a lover and defender of the Hindus, and it just came to me naturally, you know, living in India, meeting Hindus, and I discovered that Hindus were great people, tolerant people, gentle people, knowledgeable people. And that they were the inheritors of a great knowledge. That who am I, what happens when I die, what is an avatar, what is karma, what is dharma. So then I set upon defending Hindus as a journalist. This conference is about Hindu media, right? Now, though I love Hindus, I have to say that the biggest enemies of Hindus are not Muslim, they're not Christian, they're not Marxist, they are Hindus themselves. And, you know, my friend just now mentioned the fact that the New York Times, the BBC, CNN, there are so many negative stories of Hindu. Especially now that Mr. Modi is in power, you see the amount of falsehood and lies, you know, and attacks and slander that is going on in the Western press, including in my country. It's sickening. And yet, why is that? Because Hindus do not stand up for their own people. You should not clap, you should think, what can I do to stand for my own people, even if it means fighting with my bare hands? What can I do to defend these wonderful people that are the Hindus, you know? Look at the Kashmiri Pandits, you know? I mean, I was there when they were terrorized, I was there when they fled, when they became refugees in their own country. No, you know, it's a shame. It's a shame that we can say that the mainstream media, you know, is against the Hindus. But the Hindus themselves, they have the brains, they have, you know, they have the money, they have the education. Some of the best educated people in the world are Hindus. You know, wherever Hindus have gone in the world, they've done well. You know, you're the proof of it, all of you. And what do they do with that wealth? You know, you see the Muslim, they have Al Jazeera. Look at Al Jazeera, that channel. It is providing a Muslim point of view, but we know with money and brilliance, and they bought the best newscasters in the world, and recruited people from CNN and BBC, and they propagate their own, you know, their own point of view. When there was the attack in Paris, the Charlie Hebdo attack, you know, there was an internal memo to the journalists of Al Jazeera, including the Western journalists, you know, that you do not denounce the people who killed the Charlie Hebdo. They had got, you know, they got what they deserved. Why don't the Hindus have so much money? There are so many powerful families in India who have the money to start a Hindu channel, you know, which would be brilliant, you know, as good as CNN, as good as the BBC, but which will propagate a Hindu point of view. Why is it not happening? We can say whatever you want about the mainstream media, but they're still powerful people. Look here, you know, a few hundred people oppose this conference, a few hundred people. You know, small organization, you know, Muslim organization, Hindu organization, you know, South Asian, Sikh organization. And so many people have cancelled. That nice lady, Tulsi Gabbard, who was supposed to come here, she didn't come. Why? Because of pressure of a few hundred people. You are a billion people. Yep. Hindus are a billion people on this planet. One in every 7 person is a Hindu. And you have more power, more brains, more money than most other communities. You know, the West is a Kremlin civilization. Why can't you do something for your own people in the media? Why is it that your own media, you know, take the Times of India, someone who's talking about the Times of India, most powerful media, is so anti-Hindu. It's so, you know, so commercial, you know, I have never seen in my life, you know, a paper which has the front page, the second page, the third page, and the last page for ads. It's a shame on journalism. You know, and yet it is read by Hindus. So my point is, you know, Hindus have to stand up, they have to take control of the media. Social media is not enough. You know, it is true that in social media today, there is a Hindu nationalism, there is a Hindu religion. True. But social media doesn't have the power yet. No, the mainstream media still has the power. And you see that it has, because in Pondicherry there was a wonderful conference. I was supposed to be part of this conference. And there were a few articles, you know, saying, oh, nationalist, you know, rightist conference. They cancelled, you know, they couldn't get the, you know, the Alliance Française, they had to go to some other place. The mainstream media still has the power. Why can't the Hindus seize power? Even in the US, you know, how is it that there are so many negative articles on Mr. Modi, on the BJP, on Hindu? How is it that you don't stand up? It is enough to write letters or send emails or telephone the newspapers or CNN. It is enough, it has its own power. But you are, you know, just indifferent in your own comfort zone. I defend you, I love you, you are good people, but you cannot stand up for your own people. It is time that Hindus rise, you know, in the spirit of the Bhagavad Gita. But if necessary, I will fight to defend my brothers and sisters. Because today you are under attack by everybody. The Marxists, the Christian missionaries, they're coming to India, you know, they came for the tsunami, now they're coming for Kerala, and they convert millions of people. You know, Islamic fundamentalism, westernization of India is happening now, you know, there are so many ads, you know, television is coming everywhere. The villagers think that, you know, if you put a, the women think that if you put a 60 rupees pin, you can become whiter. The men think that if you put a Raman suit, you become a man. What is it? Such an ancient culture. That's only for people. The people in the West, they spend billions of dollars to get brown, and you're ashamed to be brown. So my point is, you know, wonderful people, but you know, the power of the media is important and you need to seize control of the media. Otherwise, you cannot complain about the New York Times or the BBC doing so many negative because they're just copying what the Indian journalists are saying. They're just copying what the Hindus are saying. You know, most of the Indian journalists, anti-Hindu, are Hindu themselves. NDTV and Times of India, all the intellectuals, Pankaj Mishra, they're all Hindus. So then, you have to stand up. It's time, you know, it's time that Hindus stand up because you have the number, you have the brains, you have the power, you have the money. What else do you want? What else do you want? You only need the spirit of the Kshatriyas. You have lost the spirit of the Kshatriyas, you have lost the spirit of the Kshatriyas.
That's the, I think we have got the wrong message from, I think we got carried away by what Arjuna's fears and he doesn't want to find anything. Yeah, I think more than that, I think the fact that we are not able to build diversity into some form of unity and rather diversity becomes skilled into some disunity, that's what our problem is. We prefer to have 1,000 kirana shops rather than one Walmart that project power.
Can I ask a question?
I think obviously, yes, sir. Now, if I may go to Ketkar, I mean, you're one guy who has a certain voice all the time, right? But you have got sideline thinking, oh, he's a Sanghi, he's this thing. Now, how do you battle that and how do you actually get a point across? I mean, you can please do make your points and then we'll discuss.
Thank you, Jaggi, my co-panelist and dear friends. I must thank because as per the earlier plan, I was supposed to be the first speaker and I was, as per the organizer's plan, I was supposed to be speaking on fake news there. Yeah. But as fortunately, Jaggi has already covered that and Franco has already made a point or rather raised questions why Hindus do not stand for themselves. So it makes my job easier as the last speaker in the panel to actually put the things together. See, first we need to understand, and I must agree with Jaggi on this, that the real issue is not fake news. The real issue is fake narratives. Fake news in Indian media is not a new thing. What in fact social media has done is, you know, come up with immediate counter, immediate questions, immediate clarifications, and that's why in fact, but what has happened about this whole fake news narrative? We need to understand about that. See, news is supposed to be based on facts. It has to be based on objective analysis. This is the theme of this conference, that truth is supreme. But how to get to that truth? And how to provide a Hindu perspective to that truth? Can it be, you know, contradictory? And the real challenge, it seems, and frankly you will get my perspective is simply because the moment Hindu gets educated in India, he gets more de-Hinduized. That is the core reason that we lose our Hindu perspective. We call ourselves Hindu, but we actually fail to see things from a Hindu point of view. And that's the key reason we get carried away with the whole discourse of, you know, say tolerance and intolerance, for example. But this is the place where Swami Vivekananda made his famous statement that I represent the civilization that goes beyond tolerance and teach entire world the path of universal acceptance and respect for all ways of worship. Where are we going to build and when are we going to build this whole narrative of universal acceptance? We don't tolerate each other. Catholics and Protestants tolerate each other till they convert. That is the idea of tolerance. But about that we need to build a narrative. So we need to have a basic conceptual theorization about that narrative. Then only media can pick it up. Unfortunately, because the narrative is built in English media and then it gets penetrated when it comes to the broader narrative and terminology, though I agree with Hitesh that in terms of news consumption, in terms of even the news story presentation, regional media is entirely different. You take, I'll just give you one example. From 26 February to 4th of March 2002, about entire Godhra incident, you pick up all Gujarati newspapers and you pick up all English newspaper, you will get two different stories. But ultimately, globally, what is the narrative that is being established? That is the question. How it is being penetrated? What are the terminologies that are being used? What is carnage? You know, what is massacre? Why, you know, the Sikh is always used as killings. These terminologies actually build the narrative. And unless we have a Hindu terminologies to explain this narrative, we cannot actually build a Hindu perspective in media. You know, you take many cases and many stories. I can tell you the Guardian, as far as the recent incident in Kathua. The headline itself on the front page was Muslim rape murder case in India disrupted by Hindu groups. This was the headline. Now, the demand was for CBI inquiry. Many of the, you know, strong activists here, Shefali is here and Professor Paranjpe is here, many people who, you know, raise their voices through social media on these issues and they have become brand themselves. But ultimately when you see the global repercussions of this whole fake news narrative, what are the sub-narratives that are built up around this whole case that is more important for me? I think there are three kinds of sub-narratives that are built around this whole fake news thing. I'm not saying that who is, you know, one kind of fake news and other kind of fake news, what is WhatsApp is more fake or... I'm saying is there has been, you know, a phenomenon of playing, hiding and highlighting certain facts to build a narrative that has been tendency for a long time. In fact, social media has broken that. But what is being built? Why this fake narrative thing suddenly started from the point where what Jaggi was referring to is the post 2015 thing. Precisely, if I tell you from Delhi 2015 elections, where the first church attack narrative was built. Then it was followed by Abbott Wapsi, then it was followed by the recent case, the NRC, the National Registration Citizenship Register that is supposed to be updated in Assam. What was the headline of Al Jazeera the day before this number was to be released? Dash million Muslims to be deleted from India.
Wow.
And Indian media, especially English media, responded to it. And in fact, they'd taken it forward. But the narrative was built up from there. So it is not just one-way traffic. There is a kind of alignment of forces. Anti-India, anti-Hindu, anti-Sanatana, whatever you want to call it. But that is the kind of alignment that is taking place. Do we understand the fault lines among these forces? We get carried away by regionalism or caste or religion or Sikh and Hindu or Buddhist and Hindu. Have we ever worked on how missionaries and Maoists are working together in Bastar and what are the fault lines where we can break them up? Do we have a counter strategy for that? In media, in academics, in intellectual activity? Because for that we need to understand both. Maoists as well as missionaries, but at the same time, we need to understand how to provide a Hindu solution to the population of Bastar. So it is a multifold challenge. So what is the sub-narratives that we have to deal with from Hindu perspective? Being Hindu is being regressive. That is the first narrative that is built. So you are essentially anti-Hindu, anti-Dalit, anti-this, anti-that, etc. Then Hindu nationalists are the main source of fake news. Since this government came, the fake news have been proliferating. And that's why Hindu nationalist government is protecting and encouraging such elements. These are the sub-narratives that are built up around this. Now, there is a trap. And I believe, and I actually fear that we are getting into that. We are in fact getting trapped into that. The trap of binaries. Being Hindu means you can be with multiple identities, multiple point of views, but still reaching to the same truth. That is being Hindu. But we are happy calling ourselves right-wingers. We are happy with ourselves calling Modibars. Because there is a Modibar and that's why there is a Modi hater. There is a nationalist and there is anti-nationalist. But seeing believer and non-believer is essentially non-Hindu. Seeing the world in these binaries is non-Hindu. So the biggest challenge for us is to develop a Hindu perspective on four principles. Truth is supreme. Avoiding the trap of binaries. Occupying the media space, not just in India but globally, with Hindu perspective. And providing the progressive, holistic, inclusive and global. Hindu means being cool. Hindu means open to everything. And still, he believes in something fundamental. That has to be re-narrativized, retold, and all technological media tools are to be used for the same. That is the only way we can change the fake narrative about fake news. Thank you. Thanks a lot.
What can actually be done to change the narratives internally in India first? Because what the West picks up is essentially our fault lines and they work on it. So, what can we do here that can make all the difference?
Well, one of the greatest problems, because I taught in the School of Journalism in Bangalore that was started by Shri Sree M Iyer. One of the greatest problems that parents do not want their children, Indian parents, Hindu parents, do not want their children to become journalists. They want them to become doctors or engineers or IT so that they can, you know, export them to the US. The greatest brain drain in the world is after the Hindus, man. You know, by the way, the greatest brain drain in the world is that of the Hindus. The best brains of the Hindus go abroad and they need to come back to India now. So, stop that brain drain. Education has another problem that in India you make clones. You teach them everything about Western philosophy, Western mathematics, Western this, Western that. So that the children know nothing about Kalidasa, They know nothing about a great mathematician. They know nothing that the fact that Indian astronomers were the best in the world, you know, long before Western astronomers. They know nothing about the Vedas, nothing about their own culture. So they're only good for export. So unless you change education in India, you know, you're not going to produce good journalists anywhere, because the Indian journalists see India through Western eyes. You know, most Indian journalists through India through Western eyes, you know, because they've been so Westernized, both in the education and in the school of journalism, you know, we teach a very Marxist point of view. So when they become journalists, even if they're good people, even if they're good willing, they look at India with negative eyes. As a result, you know, they tend to write negatively about India, and then they're copied by the Western correspondent. No? When a Western correspondent comes to Delhi, and I have met many, they might be good willing, they might be willing to learn, but they see so much negativity written by Indian journalists that in turn they, you know, they become negative themselves. So you have to start at the root, and you have to start, you know, teach Indian kids to be proud of to be Indians. That is the first thing. I'm a Frenchman, I was taught to be proud to be, you're Frenchman, my poets, my warriors, Napoleon, this and this and that. So Frenchmen are proud, no? But Indians are not proud to be Indian, they're not proud to be Hindu, they're ashamed to be Hindus. So if you have journalists who are ashamed to be Hindus, then naturally, you know, they will want to make people who are ashamed to be Hindus. So you need to, you know, change the whole system. And changing education in India is going to be very difficult. I don't think Mr. Modi, you know, is going to touch it this term, and next term he might not have a majority like he had the first term. So it's a big, big problem.
That's the thing. I think one had a lot of expectations that this government starts changing the narratives of the school, at least in the school curriculum, so many other things that I think. But immediately it gets branded as saffronization, and immediately all progress stops. Is there a way to get out of this trap? That why are you worried if somebody calls it saffronization? Fine, it's good. Saffron is good. Why is it that government has got totally dimified in this?
That is true, but I have a counter question. For how many years actually the Marxists ruled India? Actually in power position where Prime Minister Modi is? Not even months? But still they are controlling the educational institution, academic narrative. Who stopped you in the UPS 10 years to work on the fundamentals, what kind of education you want to bring about? After having the first experience of 5 years and seeing how the saffronization narrative was built up, what did we do? And I'm saying we. What did we do for 10 years in terms of content, in terms of grooming people, in terms of building study groups? No government, I challenge you, no government in 5 years can change the kind of last week only we were having discussion with the HIV minister, and he's saying that, you know, after following up with so many committees and so many people, I do not have a complete list of panels to rewrite the textbooks. So that is the real challenge, as it is being said that, you know, one is the brain drain issue, the best minds are not coming in the education, but at the same time, whoever are there in the education, they are to be, see, this fear of persecution is very much there. And Mr. Pranjpi is there. I've seen many, I'm myself is a JNU student. So there are actually many people who are from JNU. No. But then also we have seen the system. People who are on the on the border, or at least non-committed communists, they are afraid to make their point of view open or clear, just because of, because I personally believe that we have thought a lot about Hindu Rashtra, we haven't thought about Hindu Rajya. What kind of state, what kind of institutions we want to build if we really want to build a Hindu perspective? You can't change JNU genetically. You can't change FTII genetically. They are structurally inbuilt. You can make, you know, make few appointments here and there. It is not going to change much. How you are going to evolve a system of localized knowledge getting globalized recognition, which was a real Hindu perspective? The yatras and the varkaris who travel hundreds of kilometers with certain inspiration, what is their psychology, what is their economics, what is their sociology? It is not just religion. How much of that has actually been translated in terms of content? Once that is translated into content, then only, you know, it can go down in textbooks. So it is a very challenging. Yeah, please.
You have a Hindu Prime Minister, you have a Hindu government, you not, you have 1 billion people. Now is your time, man. We've seen that Mr. Modi, you know, when he was Gujarat Chief Minister, you know, he was a down-to-earth man, you know, he said what he believed, you know. But I love him, you know, and he's a great man, he's a great chance for India. You will not find another Narendra Modi for the next 100 years maybe. So now is the time, you know, now is the time. And now is the time to change. But even Mr. Modi is, you know, hesitant because there is so much opposition, there's so much hostility, you know, like the hostility that this conference, you know, generated. But you have to face the hostility, you know, and he's not facing it, the hostility. In Kashmir, there was a chance, you know, to chant that Article 35A, you know, where, you know, Kashmir is Muslim all over India, selling the carpet and the shawl all over, and they don't want Indians to come to Kashmir. Isn't that shameful? Mr. Modi said it. Why doesn't he do it now, for God's sake? So the same is for the media. Now is the time to change. Now we have a chance now. You know, you have a great guy called Sri Sree M Iyer. He wrote something called The Hour of God. In The Hour of God, he said, you know, there are times where God is upon earth, you know, and in those times, change can happen very fast. But if you don't change, it's a catastrophe. If we miss that opportunity, which is now, where the Hindus have a majority, and they can impose, you know, the truth, because Hindus still hold the truth to them. You know. If they miss that opportunity, it will be a great catastrophe.
We'll take some questions from the audience. Just a minute. Everybody should relate, including the judiciary. Okay, so whoever would like, we can, whoever would like to ask a question, please ask the question. Don't explain your thesis. Yeah, okay. So we'll start with them.
My question is for Prafulla. Hi, so I'm Neha.
Can you give her a mic, please?
Hinduism and important context. So there is plenty of work being done, and despite any, you know, without any government funding and support. So I want to know, how do these people reach out to the government, and what is the way to show that we have content?
See, I didn't say that I'm doing the list. I said what HRD minister's response was.
Yes, the same question.
The same question is, and again, many people, they perceive many of us, I face this problem, Hitesh. Faces this problem everywhere, that one is organizer and Panchjanya is, you know, the RSS mouthpiece, and because the RSS mouthpiece, we are government spokesperson. So, frankly, we know about what is happening in the government as much as any media person in Delhi knows. But the real point I was making about is different thing. See, essentially, please try and understand that the Marxist understanding of whole idea of revolution is basically taking over the state. It is state-centric. The institution building in post-independent India has been virtually outsourced to the Marxists by the Communist Party. So, if we really want to build, and that's why I'm talking about our role, not just government's role. Our role, yes, there are many good works that are being done in last few years. There are many good perspectives that are being built up. The entire urban Naxal perspective, or rather debate, is built by one book, one movie, and Vivek himself is here. So that shows, you know, how much power and how much struggle people are actually putting in this entire effort. But where one is, you know, state dependence. Do you believe that just state run everything is a Hindu perspective? So if it is a societal effort, how many real kind of think tanks or collaborative efforts that have come up, and branding and establishing those authors as with real Hindu perspective authors globally. That kind of networking is somewhere missing, that kind of institution building is somewhere missing, and so ultimately what happens in the form of mirror image, we start believing in their strategies. We start believing in their terminologies. So if we also take over this, and this much of funding is granted, then it has become Hindu. Sorry, it will not become Hindu this way. That is the entire point of view, because this method itself is non-Hindu. That is the entire point I was trying to make. But yes, government level expectations are much more, and on many fronts government has been cautious, defensive, whatever word you want to use, and if you have further question in this regard, then perhaps Dattaji or Mohanji is a better person to answer this, if you really want to go with that.
Jagannathan, what is the second question?
Yeah.
People and anybody who comments on the right issues, they are banned for a few days, and why aren't we doing what China did? They kicked Google out, they kicked Facebook out, they created their own social media, and now their companies are listed on NASDAQ, where they have
high language and terrorism.
Why can't we do that?
I ask. Who would you like to ask?
Okay. Good question, and it is something that's acknowledged. You have to remember who's funding Facebook and Twitter. At least Twitter, I know for a fact who's funding it. So there's a Saudi fellow, and there is a distinct bias towards that. Although it doesn't show in Twitter. Twitter seems to be more balanced than Facebook. The problem with Facebook, and I'll be specific, there are people who are paid to complain about right-wing articles. I know, because I keep getting these things. Anytime I write anything that shows a slant towards, or that shows the minority community in a slightly less light than shining spotless, these people write, they keep complaining about this particular article. The Facebook, I checked with them, I know some people who work there, they have an algorithm that sees, oh, this particular article has so many complaints, and that algorithm immediately kicks off the thing and says, sends a message saying that this is offensive content, you take it out or you'll completely pull down your page. A page may have 100,000 users, okay, we can't risk coming completely going offline to just have one post of ours being there, so we have to compromise. In fact, I should also mention, Tariq Fatah brought out one very uncomfortable fact for Facebook. Facebook has a group of people, okay, then let me finish that thing. So once the algorithm filters it out, right, sometimes it goes to the next level where there's a human intervention to actually really see, should this be taken off or not. Now Tariq Fatah, a couple of years ago, had said that there's a group in Hyderabad run by minority people which seems to lean more aggressively towards right-wing content. He tweeted this out. And I pointed this out in several of my communications with Facebook. I don't really see any response. The only thing that has changed is they seem to tweak their algorithms a little bit less now. But you have to make your noise. What Francois said is right. You scream. We are too docile. That's maybe the way that we were brought up. You cannot be docile anymore. Respect everybody. But the other side should also respect us. That is where we lose the plot.
Coming to the question, very rightly pointed out, how are you engaging artificial intelligence, machine learning in diversifying and dissecting that who the enemy is? Every narrative and every conversation that happens is being channeled. How are you harnessing the technologies to really go and identify and then counter? Thank you.
I think that's a separate session which we need to answer, but if anybody wants to answer the technology part, I think there is a question.
Yeah, we can answer that question in the technology session.
Yeah.
Meanwhile, we can
have
another question.
Guys.
Yeah.
My question is about the funding that Jerry, you brought up. He brought up the funding, why, so, in media, 3-5 million doesn't seem like a big deal. I mean, is it fear of failure, or is it is not sustainable? I mean, there is no money to be made. I'm assuming all these people who are funding, all these, they all have profit motive at some level. So why is there not money on the dharmic media side? I mean, it doesn't seem like 3-5 million is a big deal.
See, all media has business models are very difficult in the media these days. Anymore. If you leave aside some legacy media which has had long history of generating money through advertising. But today what has happened is Google and Facebook take 85% of your digital revenues. So it's not difficult to start a digital publication, but the business model is hard to combine. What I was pointing out was that I think it is not too expensive to start a digital media, provided you fund it for the very long term, and it's not very expensive. I think if you want to cover all 10 or 12 major Indian languages, this thing, you could probably do it for 200-300 crores and one-time funding, not further off that. It's not that amount of money, and we have got billionaires, at least 20-30 billionaires who can give that kind of money without a problem.
The only thing is there will be some conflict of interest. But it is possible. We need to think of those funding things, and I am certainly thinking about those things. Sorry.
Yes,
yeah,
sorry,
if you
mind.
Yeah, I'm the last. I think that
I think we're done with the session.
Just one last. Thank you very much.
Very short.
Very short. My name is Anil Shri.
Hello. Hello, hello. My name is Anil Shri. I'm from Toronto. I'm a journalist. And I just want to ask you one question is, I've been hearing this on and on and on. I'm echoing probably Francois Gautier, that mainstream media, we are vernacular, we are different. I mean, if you go to Russia, and the Russians are the mainstream language, when you go to Germany, the Germany is the mainstream language. When you go to France, the French is a mainstream language. Only in India, we, those who are here or in India, we consider English as a mainstream media.
So what is your question?
My question is, when are we going to change that? When are we going to learn and move forward? Is it true or false?
But you see, you know,
I'm saying it, first of all.
In Israel, you know, they had a very ancient language with it. Become half dead, you know, they revived it and now they have a national language. In India you have Sanskrit, which is the mother of all languages, and I know for a fact that several great personalities like Sri Aurobindo and Swami Vivekananda said Sanskrit ought to become the modern Indian language, but it did not happen. So there's no need to cry now, because you have the most ancient language, you know, which can be revived, it can be used, but it's never been done. So English is the national language of India now. It's a fact. What to do?
I think we can take some of these questions offline.
Thank you. Thank you, Jaggi, for a very thought-provoking and stimulating session. Thank you to your co-panelists, Prafulla.